Hey guys, what's going on? You are listening to Future Imperfect, only on thisweekingeek.net. I'm one of your hosts, Mike the Birdman Dodd, but I'm not alone through this trek across the stars. I'm joined by the co-creator of the GeekCast Radio Network,
Steve Megatron Phillips.
You know, it's weird to actually say that and not have Blanchard in my ear for a change. It's a nice welcome change on this show. But yes, guys, we are talking Trek here on This Week in Geek. This is going to be one of our new shows launching forward into 2012. And basically, we got the idea for the show. I got the idea for the show while watching Star Trek's documentary, Trekkies, which actually ties into our topic today. There was a talk show years upon years ago that's actually on the radio called Talking Trek. And it was basically an online convention. They said some people talk French, some people talk German, we talk Trek. That's sort of the same mantra we're going to proceed with our show, Future Imperfect, which is the name me and Steve came up with to describe, well, the future's pretty cool, the future's pretty bright, but it's not exactly perfect when you look at all the problems that happen in Star Trek. But that's not to say that there aren't creative solutions with the United Federation of Planets, treaties, you know, all sorts of neat things that happen with Star Trek. So I guess, Steve, to let's get people introduced to you, because we've had you on This Week in Geek before, but since this is a new show, let's get people reacquainted with who you are.
Well, first of all, I'm, of course, like you said before, the co-creator of the GeekCast Radio Network. I'm an avid fan of many things geek, obviously. I love films, I love cartoons, I love Transformers, and of course, Star Trek. I have a deep fascination with voice acting that I'd like to actually partake in the future. I've interviewed a great deal of famous voice actors, and pretty much I'm a web tech guru for the most part.
And it's nice to have you a part of working with us here on This Week in Geek. You've actually taken over a good chunk of the web duties from our former guy, Steve Snowball Sailor, who just merely just doesn't have time to necessarily do that for us all the time now. So now we have you, and the website, well, it mostly works. Eventually we'll fix that stupid Facebook thing. So we do apologize for people that are trying to comment via Facebook. But speaking of things
Well, it does work, but The thing is Facebook's open graph thing. It's the way it's set up. It works flawlessly despite what it tells you.
It's witchcraft is what it is.
Yes.
Just saying. All right, guys. Now, before we start things off, and I want to kick things off in the right way, as sort of a welcome to the new show sort of thing, I'm giving some stuff away. Oh, that's right. So this comes just courtesy of Paramount Pictures Canada and USOPLY. I'm giving out a copy of the collector's edition of Klingon Monopoly. That's right, in full Klingon. So kaplach, warriors. You can actually read this in full Klingon, but there is also the bilingual translation into good old, you know, standard Federation English, if you want to play this. And I'm also giving away the Season 1 Blu-rays for Star Trek The Next Generation, the sampler disc that comes out later on this month. I'll be sending that out. Now, this contest is open to North America only, simply because, well, the Blu-ray is NTSC Region 1, first off. And number two, I don't want to ship a thing overseas because I will get raped in shipping charges. So what you have to do to win this is send me a one-paragraph Klingon-inspired war speech. So basically, tell me how you'll drink the blood of your enemies, smash their skulls into dust, and hear the cries of their women or something. So to do this, write Klingon War Cry as the subject in your email, and you will be emailing feedback at thisweekingeek.net, and we will be accepting entries all the way up until February 8th, where we will notify the winner via email, and we may even call you on the show if you happen to include your phone number. I think it'd be kind of cool. So anyway, so like I said, guys, today's inaugural episode is going to be talking about the fandom of Star Trek. So how me and Steve got involved, some of our memories, talking about the conventions, the fan clubs, and what it means to be a Trek fan in 2012 these days. But before we do that, we have a segment on the show, which we're going to call the LCARS segment, where we take a look at the library computer access system and see what random item we can talk about in Star Trek this week. This will be done by Steve each and every show. So Steve, take it away with the LCARS computer access system this week.
Hello and welcome to LCARS. Today we begin our first of many journeys into Star Trek's computer library to discuss, quite frankly, something awesome. In this debut episode, I'd like to talk about the ship that began it all, the Enterprise. When I say the Enterprise, I don't mean the NX-01 Quantum Leap Enterprise, no. I mean the original series Enterprise.
NCC-1701. No bloody A, B, C, or D.
Program complete. Enter when ready.
The USS Enterprise, NCC-1701, was a Federation Constitution-class heavy cruiser that was in service with Starfleet in the mid to late 23rd century. In the course of her career, the Enterprise became the most celebrated starship of her time. The ship itself endured 40 years of service, discovery, upgrades, and at least two refits, unlike most of her later namesakes. It achieved much of what many starships, captains, and her crews merely dreamed of. Much of that being first contacts, military engagements, and time travels. She achieved her most lasting fame from the 5-year mission under the command of Captain James T. Kirk, my favorite captain out of all of Starfleet. This Enterprise, unfortunately, was destroyed over the Genesis planet in 2285 in a battle with some rogue Klingons to save Captain Spock. In Star Trek III, The Search for Spock. Suffice it to say, Star Trek wouldn't have been quite what we know it is today without the specific ship to guide our light into this great fandom. So, with that, I'll toss it back to the podcast with Mike and myself with the following clip.
In any case, I'll be watching. See you out there.
And we're back with Future Imperfect.
Yeah! We are still getting
so,
that.
Yeah.
Yes, as you guys can tell, me and Steve, we're just kind of getting
definitely still getting the hang of it.
Yeah, just because me and Steve have actually never worked together separately on a show. We've worked together with some of our friends. So this is sort of our shakedown cruise for the USS Future Imperfect. So bear with us while we figure things out. So like I said, Steve, thank you for doing that element on the USS Enterprise. What we're going to talk about next week, who knows? I'm just going to have Steve open a Star Trek dictionary and pick something. So like I said, today's topic is the fandom. And my fandom goes all the way back to probably, I remember grade 7 specifically when I got into this. So I was in maybe, I'm trying to think what the year would have been. Probably around 92, 93. So Star Trek was probably in its 5th or 6th season. And I had just started getting into it. As one of my teachers in public school named Mr. Collins, I found out he was a Star Trek fan. I had him loan me some of his Star Trek tapes that he would record off of television. Because in my family, we didn't have cable. We had satellite, but I wasn't allowed to use it. So I could only get my Trek in bits and bursts. And I started watching. And the first episode I saw was Descent. Part 1 and 2, which is where Data's brother Lore takes over a small Borg collective and gives Data the emotion chip, and he tries to kill Geordi, and this, that, and the other thing. We also see it's Commander Troi take over the Enterprise and destroy a Borg cube using a sun, which is pretty creative. And that's when I really kind of got into it, because my friend Wayne Richards at the time was another huge Trek guy, and we started talking about the ships, the technology, and then for Christmas that year, 1991, 92, whenever, my parents got me the Enterprise-D, the Romulan Warbird, and the shuttlecraft Goddard, which I still currently have in my house being piloted by Ensign Wesley Crusher. as of this recording. And that's kind of how I got into it. And there would be a small gathering of Star Trek fans, and I don't know why this happened, but I'm from a small town called Owen Sound, Ontario, Canada. And for some reason, in the Grey County Mall, which is affectionately recalled the Dirt Mall, if you lived in the area, it was the small little ghetto mall, they had a Star Trek convention there once. There were Klingons, Counselor Troy, not Marina Sirtis, but someone dressed like her, and some other people. But the weird thing is they had the bridge of the original Enterprise, 1701, the original, and Counselor Troy was on the bridge. It was very weird. And that's pretty much all I can remember about how I got into the fandom. What about you, Steve?
Well, what actually began me jumping into the fandom was my parents actually were huge Trekkies. My mom grew up with it, as did my dad, with the original series. And, of course, by proxy, that's what I got to know it from. I used to sit and watch television with my parents, and if, you know, pretty much everybody knows when you're a kid and there's the big TV out in the living room, you watch what your parents watch if you want to stay up later. So, yeah, I pretty much watched the original series and then TNG, which I both series I greatly loved. And to help encourage it, my parents bought me a ton of the action figures, the ships, VHS tapes, for those of you that know what those are. It was awesome. And then one year I actually got to go to a Trek convention, which to me was just freaking awesome. I got to meet John DeLancey at the time, got a autograph, and I still have it to this day, perfectly contained and everything. And I've seen every Star Trek movie since Generations in the theater. And I'd have to say, out of everything, my whole exposure with Trek has just been a long journey that I've just had nothing but good things to say about.
I'd say I'm probably the same way with you, where I've seen every Trek movie in theaters. I think the only one I didn't see in theaters, at least initially, was, I think, Nemesis, but I'm not even 100% sure of that. Although I'd say the worst of the bunch was Insurrection, just saying.
I'd have to agree with you.
That movie was fucking terrible. Yes, by the way, was. We're explicit, just so you know. I guess you haven't figured that out yet. But, being a Trek fan in the 90s, that was the heyday, in my opinion. I mean, you had TNG had come to an end in 1994. You had the revival of the other series on the air through reruns. You still had DS9 was running until 1999. Voyager ended in I think, 2002. Enterprise was launched during this time, which was sort of the prequel to the original series, like 100 years before Spock and Kirk were running around. And TNG movies were still being made, good or bad. And I remember a lot of the action figures being just, there were so many of them, and I'm really regretting the fact that I stopped collecting for a while, because I've always wanted to find a Playmates era Voyager, and I look on eBay and I don't see anything for less than $100 to $300. I've never seen one go below $100, which sucks. And I hear on the convention circuit they can go about as high as $6 if they're complete in box. Now, one of the interesting things about the fandom is, it's how we all meet and how we all find each other. When I was a kid, like I said, back in grade 7, there was a Star Trek club at my public school. And as I went to high school, there wasn't necessarily a formal Star Trek club, but we knew how to find each other. Like, I had a friend of mine, Mark, and he's the guy that got me into TNG stuff really, really, really heavily. I remember one year he gave me the Star Trek technical manual because he was getting out of it, I was getting into it. And my friend Jarrett Chessel was also a bit of a Star Trek nut too. So we used to randomly just do things at school that were Star Trek-ish. The one memory I have, and I'll never forget this, we were in grade 11 or 12, so 98, 99, something like that. We have this huge cafeteria. at West Hill, which is the high school that I went to. And they always played music during lunch, right? So one day, someone decides to put a sound effects CD in the CD player. And we have the Star Trek alarm klaxon as one of the sounds on it.
Oh, that's awesome.
And it goes off, and then the person didn't want to play that, and they hit another button, and it was a grandfather clock. So my buddy Chessel jumps to his feet. He goes, "Red alert, all hands to battle stations, grandfather clock decloaking off the port bow." And me and him just jump to our feet and run out of the cafeteria. Everyone was just stood there just stunned, didn't know what the hell happened. But I just remember that as one of my very early memories of Star Trek, is that's how a lot of us in our little group found each other, is through the grandfather clock decloaking off the port bow. We also randomly played the role-playing game, which at the time was run by Last Unicorn Games, which we will talk about that on the show, as there have been several incarnations from FASA and other groups across the world who hold the license to it, such as Decipher, who also made the card game, if I'm not mistaken, as well. But before we go any further, I guess, Steve, do you have any unusual stories of the fandom before we jump into where it's going now and where it's gonna go?
Well, for instance, while I was watching Trekkies, I found myself quite disturbed by some of the weird things fans happen to, decide they want from, the actors. One of which being somebody went around trying to get a vial of Scotty's blood.
Oh, yeah, that guy.
Which to me, that is beyond obsessive. Like, I can see wanting to, you know, meet him, get a handshake, you know, hang out with him, get a, you know, an autograph. But to sit there and want their damn blood. Well, that's just freaking weird.
Come on, you can clone then, Scotty.
That is true. You could, if it were legal.
You could take
it to the 24th century and preserve him.
See, there you go. I mean, this time he doesn't have to get caught in a transporter accident. He can just be cloned. He can be like Khan in Space Seed.
God.
See, that's how far I'm willing to take it. But yeah, like, I remember in Trekkies, my favorite story out of that one is where John Delancey's talking, and this is in the first Trekkies, and he's talking about how he's walking down the street one day, and a guy...
Oh, I love that.
And a guy says, "Are you Q?" And he's like, "Yeah. Can you bring people back from the dead?" Only if I like them. Cool. And then he walked away.
That was hilarious.
That was the best story out of Trekkies right there. And for those of you that may not necessarily know what we're talking about, Trekkies was a documentary that was made back in 1998, I think, produced by Denise Crosby, a.k.a. Lieutenant Tasha Yar, who died in the second season episode, Skin of Evil. My God, I realized how much of this crap I know right off the top of my head. And it's basically an examination of Trekkies, but also has interviews with the original cast of the show. More of the original show than TNG, which I found to be remarkably interesting. Although, I don't think Shatner spoke during that doc, but it was mostly George Takei,
Nichelle Nichols.
Nichelle Nichols, Leonard Nimoy. The guy that plays Chekhov, Walter Koenig, Will Wheaton was interviewed at one point. I think they talked to Frakes a little bit. I don't know if they talked to Stewart. They talked to Stewart more in Trekkies 2 than they do anything else. But yeah, and it's an interesting documentary. They also show several obsessive fans over the course. And actually, one of the fans on there, the guy who ends up designing his own starships and wearing his own uniform. Surprisingly enough, this guy went on to be a big deal in Hollywood. This guy went on to design the Vipers for Battlestar Galactica, worked on Superman Returns in the series finale of Enterprise. So he's done a fair number of things. He's still pretty active in CG modeling and miniatures, as far as I know, whose name completely escapes me at this moment. But it's just amazing to see what the fandom can create and where it can lead. Now, one of the groups that we actually had a chance to actually talk to before this episode aired is actually one of the big fan clubs for Star Trek, and they are StarFleet. They're known as one of the largest fan organizations out there currently for Star Trek. Over 4,500 members as of this recording, if I'm pretty sure. So I had a chance to sit down with Dave Blazer of StarFleet, and you can find their website over at, I'm just pulling it up right now, so just give me a second. That's sfi.org. And here's the interview that I had a chance to record with Dave last week about the fandom, the conventions, and some of the cool things you can do if you happen to be a member of this wonderful fan organization. Hey guys, what's going on? You are listening to Future Imperfect, the, well, only Star Trek podcast currently on This Week in Geek. I am your host, Mike the Birdman Dodd. And well, as you've heard me and Steve Megatron Phillips talk over the last little bit, we're talking about the fandom of Star Trek in our premiere episode. And it's something that I always wondered about being a part of, being one of those guys in the Star Trek fan clubs. Am I going to be one of those people that wears the pointy ears and the Spock uniform all day long? Well, sadly, folks, I think it's actually starting to shape up that way. I wear a comm badge everywhere I go, and occasionally I'll get some looks. But I recently became a part of an organization, and they're actually sponsoring This Week in Geek with a complimentary membership for myself. And I'm talking about StarFleet, one of the fan clubs for Star Trek. Not the official one, because there are several other fandoms out there. But StarFleet's the one that I took a look at, simply because these guys seemed a little more personal. And little did I know that just over an hour and a half away from where I live right now, the president of StarFleet lives not too far from me. So I want to welcome Dave Blazer to the show, the president of StarFleet, one of the biggest fan clubs in Star Trek right now. Welcome to Future Imperfect, Dave.
Thanks, Mike.
So I guess I got to ask for all the listeners out there of This Week in Geek and Future Imperfect, what is StarFleet?
Well, simply put, StarFleet is a Star Trek fan club. Where we got started really was back in the 70s. There was a gentleman down in Lubbock, Texas, I believe, who wanted to get together and really celebrate and get enjoy Star Trek. And so he got some of his friends together, and they started their own fan club together called the USS Enterprise. This is back in 1973. So Star Trek had been off the air for about 4 years, and they were the ones who really wanted to kind of live that lifestyle and enjoy the show and try and see what they could do to get things happen again and or really love, you know, get their enjoyment of Star Trek out there and share it with everyone else.
Now, what has it been like to be a part of StarFleet, simply because now we have the internet era and new media, Facebook, Twitter, etc.? What's it been like to grow the fan club from the days where it was just people meeting in maybe the odd convention hall and exchanging newsletters to being this 21st century entity?
It's wildly different than what it was, even going back to, you know, the 80s. Back when StarFleet first started and throughout the course of the years, your real only source for getting news and information about the franchise and about what was going on with the production of the motion picture when it came out in 1979 and all the movies since then was from fan clubs. And StarFleet had a bit of a hand in that at some point. We had some well-connected members a long time ago with people who, you know, worked in the studios, who worked for Paramount and for later Viacom, who could get the skinny for us and provide that information. And it was kind of, you know, one of those exclusive things that we could have for our members. The internet era really, really changed that for us, where it became much more easy and convenient to get that kind of information off the web. You know, you got StarTrek.com, you've got TrekToday.com, TrekWeb.com, all those places you can go and you can look up for all of that information, what's happening with the studios and what's happening with the show and the movie. You know, you can go right now, in fact, and do a search and find, you know, that the sequel to 2009 Star Trek started filming very recently, and they, you know, I've got all the cast back together and it's like a big family reunion. being part of a fan club now, it's a lot less of getting the latest skinny and the latest news. It's much more about the social interaction, having fun together, interacting, and really sharing that love of Star Trek and doing other things together as well. A lot of Starfleet chapters, tend to be very community focused as well. They want to do things that are positive and good in their communities.
Now, that's something that actually really attracted me to Starfleet, is that you guys are a more social fan club. So can you explain some of the things that make Starfleet more social than, say, some of the other organizations that are out there right now?
Well, one of the best examples that I can give you is that there's the official Star Trek fan club, and there's another organization out there that they're large, but for the most part, it's more or less a magazine subscription than anything else. You can walk down the street, pass by somebody who's a member of the official fan club and not even know that they're a member. Whereas with Starfleet, a lot of it has to do with getting together in the clubs, interacting, having fun, like I said. So the chapters, a lot of chapters will get together on a monthly basis or even sometimes much more frequently than that, or via the internet and do various, email lists or online gaming, things of that nature. So it's a lot more social and interactive. So when you're walking down the street, if you're a member of Starfleet and there's another member of Starfleet who happens to live in your town, if you've gone through the same chapter, you've been part of the same chapter, you see them, you know that they're a part, and you can have somebody to interact with and socialize with. It's like a big, it's not really a big, but I guess it's a way to expand your circle of friends.
Now, I understand Starfleet, now the different chapters, they do different social events. And the one that you and I are a part of, Dave, we're part of the USS Hadfield, correct?
That is correct.
And we all get together about once a month, and we do either a trivia night or a Mexican night or just basically different things to get together as a community. What are some of the other events that other chapters put together for their members?
It's wild and varied depending on the chapter and the different personalities involved. There's one chapter actually down in, I want to say, Missouri, that right now they're doing a play by Twitter role playing game, which I thought was amazing when I saw that this today when I was reading status reports. Other chapters get together and they'll do, like I said, some community type work. Some chapters will do some fundraising for a local charity. I've heard of various chapters who have been involved with Habitat for Humanity. Some of them just get together, they'll do movie nights, they'll do things like that. I'm trying to think of some good examples for you. That's the kind of thing they do.
Now, yeah. I understand, Dave, that once a year there's a big get together that everybody mm-hmm. does, and this year it's being held where again?
In Memphis, Tennessee.
And what is that event? Basically, if people wanted to check out Starfleet and they want to see what the big grand event is that we do every year, what is it, and tell us about it?
Well, Starfleet annually has an international conference, or what we call the International Conference. It's a requirement for Starfleet to have a once-a-year business meeting for the board of directors and for our executive committee, where we get together, we talk about the business of Starfleet, running the organization, and address the various things that we have to do on a business level. Expanding on that, though, we make it into kind of a social weekend as well, where members can get together and have... let me start with the actual typical order of events. Friday night, we usually have a nice dinner with what we call the Marine Mess, where the Starfleet Marines have their own, it's kind of like a ceremonial type dinner. And you get together, you have fun, you socialize, you interact with people. Opening ceremonies are later on Friday night. Saturday is our general session, where we have kind of the state of the fleet speeches that are happening. Each of the executive committee members gets up, gives their report about what's happening with their particular department, how we're spending the finances of the club very responsibly, making sure that we do things correctly. Then we do hand out our annual awards. We present our scholarship winners. And then we usually have in the afternoon our convention type programming, more geared specifically towards Starfleet and the chapters and interacting, having fun. In some cases, you'll have some how to do things within the your chapters, like how to put together a newsletter, how to manage your chapter's finances, things like that. But you'll also have the focus on what you're doing to have fun. Saturday night, usually we have a banquet and charity auction, and followed very quickly by the dance. That's the word I was looking for, dance. And there's always room parties as well that take place, where a lot of socializing, interacting, bouncing from room to room, having lots of drinks, and having fun.
See, and that's, I think, something that definitely takes Starfleet into a whole new realm of the fandom, is the fact that it's so accessible and people can do this. So Dave, I guess to you as my final question, if people want to find out more about Starfleet and join up, where would they have to go?
You can find out pretty much everything you want to know from our website at www.sfi.org. Or if you want, you can drop an email to myself at cs@sfi.org.
Excellent stuff, Dave. Well, I gotta say, I'm really looking forward to talking to you again here on Future Imperfect. And, gotta say, it's great to be a part of Starfleet. And hopefully you guys out there will take the initiative and join Starfleet. Find your local chapters. Go out there and make some new friends. Celebrate Trek. And, hey, be like me. Carry a comm badge everywhere you go. Well, guys, that's pretty much going to do it for this interview segment for Future Imperfect. I'm going to throw things back to me and Steve, and we'll be back right here on Future Imperfect, only on ThisWeekInGeek.net.
And welcome back to Future Imperfect.
So, big thanks to Dave from Starfleet for actually coming on the show and talking about it. Now, as of this episode's recording, well, we're recording this on Monday. It's going to be coming out on Wednesday. So from the future, there actually is an event in Toronto this weekend for the Klingons. There is CAG Fest in Toronto. Just type that into Google, K-A-G Fest Toronto, and I'm sure something's bound to come up via there. That's one of the neater things I found out about looking at some of the different fan clubs and groups that still gather to this very day, is that they still get together in costume. They do crazy things like have Klingon bowling and other weird shit like that.
That's kind of cool.
Yeah, it is, because the fact that because the internet exists, I wondered if the fandom would fracture, because now we can all access the fan club from anywhere we want. We can be at home, be at work, on our mobile devices. So what's the need to gather anymore? And I'm glad organizations like Starfleet exist and CAG, because these groups are still out there. I mean, one of the things I got from watching Trekkies 1 and 2 about the fandom is it got me revitalized into realizing just how big of a Star Trek fan I actually was. I want to be that uniform-wearing weirdo. I want to be surrounded by people who can tell me who was the director of photography on this episode, what kind of phaser is that, what's the refit condition of the Enterprise C sort of thing, who was the commanding officer. I like that. I like being around what I would call them a super nerd. And I don't mean that in a derogatory term. I mean that in the fact that they understand a fandom so deeply and so purely that I don't know. I mean, I think the best way to describe it is it's like the fandom got left behind. I mean, because you see people talk about Transformers these days. You see them talk about any number of different anime shows. I mean, My Little Pony's come into its own recently with the whole brony thing, and Trekkies, we've kind of been left behind. I mean, yeah, we had the 2009 movie. That was awesome. Star Trek Online, still awesome. But you always hear more about Star Wars in the popular media or something else. It's like Trekkies got left behind.
Oh, yeah. And it's kind of sad to see that the only form of anything Star Trek nowadays is in just the Abrams-verse. I mean, you don't see anything anymore.
Yeah, because it's like they forgot it existed. And the fact that there was a series of novels, I think done by Del Rey, don't quote me on that, which attempted to continue the universe after the movies and the shows had ended. I think it's terrible. I've read the summaries online. They kill Captain Janeway, and the Borg are completely destroyed, and the universe is just, it's not the Trek that I recognize. And even Star Trek Online takes a cue from the Abrams verse in the fact that it takes into effect that the supernova near Romulus still exploded. Now the Klingons are at war with the Federation, the Borg are back, the Dominion are a new threat again. And it's all because of the Abrams verse, which is great that it revitalized a property that had been gone for quite some time. In fact, I can't remember. This is the only time in my life. Think about it, dude. There's no new Trek on television right now.
And I think that's kind of sad because I personally looked forward to watching a Star Trek show besides Enterprise, because I have different reasons for that, but I'll get into that at some other time in the future. I liked seeing this show on TV, and it was like my weekly thing to go watch.
Yeah, and now that we don't have that, like I said, I wondered what happened to the fandom, but by talking with people like Dave, the fandom's there. It's just, I guess we're quieter than we ever have been, although there's always Star Trek conventions going on. I mean, in fact, I just read about this huge one happening this year. Happens in Las Vegas, second week there, and they've got Kate Mulgrew's coming out, Avery Brooks, Patrick Stewart, because this is the 25th anniversary of Star Trek The Next Generation is this year.
Wow.
Yeah, I know. I mean, 25 years. Holy crap. I can't believe it's been that old. I mean, we are now those people saying, man, I remember when Captain Picard, this is our generation's Trek. It's weird to think about that. I mean, think about that. I mean, Voyager's 25th anniversary will be in 10 years. Because it started back in 1995.
That's just crazy.
I know, just to think how old all these shows are. But yeah, so they got this huge thing. There's also a cruise. There's a cruise you can go on with Garrett Wong, who played Ensign Harry Kim, John Billingsley, who played Dr. Phlox, Denise Crosby, who played Tasha Yar. You can go hang out with these guys on a cruise ship for a week. It's $2,500. But it may be legitimately kind of cool. I'm actually kind of looking into it if I can somehow find a way to raise that kind of money by the end of the year. But that's really cool, the fact that there are these things still out there. There are still these little mini conventions. And I'm surprised, to go back to my original point, that there is no Trek on TV. Because look at the success of the sci-fi series that are out there now. I mean, Fringe is out there. There's the there was previously, up until about 2 years ago, the revitalized Battlestar Galactica, which was a fantastic series. And we'll actually talk about that here on Future Imperfect, because I would love to do a comparison of Star Trek versus other universes. And I think Battlestar is one that definitely needs to be examined. But it's a great time for sci-fi on television right now, but there is no great long-running franchise. I mean, Stargate's done in all its incarnations now. Battlestar's off the air. What do we have in terms of sci-fi television on the air right now? We've got Alcatraz, I guess.
Which is kind of sci-fi, but it's also a J.J. Abrams production, so
it's almost its own thing. But you say J.J. Abrams, it's almost its entire different like subgenre. I'm trying to think what else we got. Fringe. I'm thinking here, what else? Terra Nova.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't consider any of the Supernatural shows to be sci-fi. I mean, there's like Doctor Who, but that's so spread out that it's just generally sci-fi. Because Star Trek and Doctor Who, yeah, they both happen in space, but Doctor Who has more, it's a more open storytelling device because of the whole time and space thing. They can go anywhere at any time. So they're not necessarily tied to a starship or a starbase. And if they want their episode to happen inside of a giant mushroom, they could, in theory, find a way to make it happen inside of a giant mushroom. I'm trying to think. Like, it's weird, though, to look out on the fandom. I remember in the late 90s, in probably 96 as early, there were crap tons of Star Trek fan sites.
Oh, yeah, everywhere.
I remember there were so many play-by-email groups. There were archives dedicated to it. Nowadays, there are still Star Trek websites out there, and there are some really good ones. But it's almost like it's an endangered species now. Like, they're hard. Like, the good ones are really hard to find.
Yeah, and it's kind of saddening because, I mean, it's like almost like sci-fi has kind of died out in a sense, and we need actually somebody to come along and pick it back up. And I think a new Star Trek series would do just that.
Yeah, I mean, I completely agree, because it would be nice to have a Star Trek series that was meant for us and not necessarily have to be in the Abrams verse. And there was talk in the fandom about what's it going to be. Could it be on a Borg vessel? Is it like a Section 31 ship? Is it a Klingon ship or something like that? And it would be nice just to have something that was uniquely us. And there are some wonderful writers out there that could bring this to life. I mean, I'm pretty sure Ronald Moore could bring this back to television if he wanted. Like, there's no reason why we shouldn't have a Trek on the small screen, not just the big screen. Like I said, I am looking forward to the Abrams movie. And I will say the Abrams movie did do a fair chunk to punch me in the arm to get back into it. I mean, I contacted Playmates when the movie came out, and they sent me a bunch of stuff, which we covered when the first movie came out a couple of years ago here on Twig. I still have my phaser. I've got my my bridge set. I've a couple of my friends gave me Star Trek figures for my birthday. I think I still have Spock, Kirk, and Dr. McCoy somewhere. But I don't know. I mean, I wish the fandom was a little more vocal. I mean, George Takei did a video a couple of weeks ago where he was talking about he wants us to unite in peace, Star Wars and Star Trek fans, against a common enemy. That common enemy being Stephanie Meyer's Twilight. Which I think is a wonderful thing.
And reality TV.
And reality TV in general. I completely agree. We, as fans, should unite and destroy these rat bastards. But I don't know. Like I said, it's like our fandom has its head down, and I don't know why. And I know there's going to be people out there that are disagreeing with me. Tell me where you are so we can find you. Feedback at thisweekingeek.net. We want to talk with you. We want to have you guys involved. Like, the idea of Future Imperfect, like I said, is to take the spirit of what Talking Trek was. I'd like for us to be that again in the new media age. I mean, just for us to see where all of our friends and family have gone that are Trekkies, to bring back the heyday of the 90s. And I'm sure that the new Abrams movies will do that. So I guess, Steve, before we close things out, where do you think the fandom's going?
Honestly, I think a lot of them are still very interested. I just think that a lot of them have kind of gone into a sort of dormancy, just based on the fact that there's nothing new going on. I mean, we've had a couple years since the Abrams film. Before that, there was a couple years that we didn't have anything in between, and then now we've been postponed because of that G.I. Joe movie to 2013 before we're even going to see another Trek film. So that'll have been another 4 years. So I think that there needs to be some kind of a public resurgence, and not just conventions. I think there needs to just be a widespread something to pop up that can unite all of us to try and get something going. Just because at this point, I don't see many new fans coming to the franchise, and I don't see many of them staying only for the fact that there's no media for it.
You know what has to happen, Steve? I just had this thought right now. There needs to be a Star Trek flash mob in somewhere very public, like Times Square or something. Get as many nerds as you can in their uniforms just to show up and just dance or something. I don't know. Fight a Borg or something. There could be something. I mean, Star Wars, the Old Republic did it in Times Square. They had a flash mob. We deserve one, too. So that is my challenge to the Star Trek community. Let's organize a Star Trek flash mob in a very public place on a very nice day sometime this year. Let's remind the world that good things still happen, that Gene Roddenberry's dream did not die, that despite the doomsday clock being 5 minutes to midnight right now, we can set that all the way back to nothing. Because you know what? He dreamed of a better world for all of us. Didn't matter what race you were, what orientation you were, didn't matter anything. We united for a common purpose. It was to explore space, to basically broaden our horizons as human beings and as a collective, you know, force in the universe. So, as inspirational as I'm sure that sounds, I'm pretty sure that I've run out of things to talk about the fandom. I know we're still out there. I know we still exist. We've gone underground for right now. But I'm looking for you guys to be like the Bayshore, or the Bayshore, the Bajor Resistance. Let me know you're out there. Feedback at thisweekingeek.net. Also, guys, do not forget our contest. I want to give away a copy of Klingon Monopoly, which we're going to have a review of that next show. That'll probably be put together by my able-bodied young ward, Scotty Bordas, or myself, depending. And we're actually going to have a review of Star Trek items every show, brought to you by ThinkGeek.com and whoever else will send us stuff to let you know what's worth your hard-earned gold-pressed latinum. So anyway, for Future Imperfect, I want to thank everyone for coming out to the show. Like I said, email feedback at thisweekingeek.net with your one-paragraph Klingon war speech. I want to hear it. If it's an actual Klingon, I will take the time to translate it and find someone who can speak Klingon to do it on the show. So anyway, for Future Imperfect, we have been
Steve Megatron Phillips.
And I've been Mike the Birdman Dodd saying, live free or die hard. We'll catch you guys again next time right here on ThisWeekInGeeks.net's Future Imperfect.